Welcome to BTA Politics Live on Business Television Africa with me, Winston Taki. This is your exclusive business and economic program where we give you political analysis from dimensional cases. And today we'll be delving on very interesting issues that have to do with the case of Ghana's debt ratio, where it has hit at the moment, seems to be very alarming. At the moment, we have hit at the tone of $2.5 billion. We'll be assessing this situation, whether how this is going to impact on our economy going forward into the 2016 election, and whether our economy and businesses will be able to survive considering the challenging factors that have led us to this particular situation. We'll be also touching on the case of ECG, whether the case of water bills, which at the moment have been technically indicated with technology, where we've seen them being used as a scratch card, as a means of payment. We'll be seeing whether the economic impact analysis of this on the lives of people continuously. We've seen the cases of the GMPC trying to create an energy city, whether this is also a prudent approach of the use of the taxpayers' money. This is in the House of Parliament, but we are assessing, considering the huge amount of money that were being paid as accommodation in terms of rent. We'll be getting into more into that shortly. Stick and stay right back. Welcome back to BTA Politics with me, Winston Taki, your exclusive political and economic show. Today, we'll be delving in a bit of economics on the moment, and I'm sure I have your attention at the moment. We'll be starting with the issue of the Ghana's external debt hitting to the tune of $2.5 billion. It was projected up to 2015 that we are likely to hit $800 million. But from 2015 to now, our debt stock has risen to the tune of $2.5 billion. What are the factors leading to that case? Does this reflect in our revenue generation? How much as interest are we going to be paying over the next 3 years on our debt, considering we've been going into the euro bond market to borrow billions and billions of dollars in order to refinance certain some of the debts we've been going on to. Some have been intended to refinance debt, some to refinance infrastructure in the country. So this and many more we'll be delving on today. Today, I'm privileged to have as my guest a financial analyst, is an expert in his own person, and is also the Dean of School of Business and Leadership. He's here with me to discuss all the necessary issues today on BTA Politics. It goes by the name Dr. Ebenezer Mensa. Actually, I hope I got the name right.
Ashley.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. All right, Doctor, welcome to the show.
It's a pleasure meeting you.
Likewise. How's the day been?
Not bad. We have a very fluctuating weather condition, but we're coping with it as usual.
You hope the rain this time around wouldn't cause a June 10th?
At all. Far from that. We are far from that. I passed by a cycle the other time, and the reminiscence wasn't a good one. And so I pray that doesn't recur in our social setting. It isn't a good one at all.
How long are we going to be praying when the needed authorities need to stand up to get the things fixed at the moment?
That's a very good question. Actually, we need to back prayers with actions, you know. And when we pray, we need to ask for God's guidance and directions as to what we should do. It's not a matter of praying and then sitting down and expecting the miracle to happen. We have to walk the talk. And so when the ideas come, we have to implement them. Fortunately, there are some initiatives that have been taken through the Accra Metropolitan Assembly, that's the AMA, and we hope this would work out effectively.
What is your people resolve. Calling of his resignation? Is this a prudent call, or is he a bit too satirical at the moment?
Well, satire, the word as you use, may be based on some perhaps information you have that may not be shared on air. And as a matter of fact, I have observed that we as Ghanaians sometimes hate people who do the right thing. When especially you crack in the whip and many people are affected, then they would begin to call you names. But the question is his action for the betterment of the generality of the people? If it is not intended to favor a section, but then the general people, then it should continue. As a matter of fact, he's someone who came up with some foreign ideas. And you know, I have realized in Ghana here, we sometimes find difficult embracing using alien concepts. And when it so happens, you have to stick your ground to make sure it works. And over time, people will reap the benefits of what you've started. And knowing where he is coming from, you know, he was in New York, where some of us resided. And we know how they take, you know, the environment cleanliness to be. And that's what he's trying to pursue. And I know if he's given the opportunity, he'll be able to turn things around in the city. We are used to filth. And so if someone comes to drag us off the field, we may not accept it overnight. It may take a while for us to embrace that concept as not only a novelty, but intended to improve on our own health and then develop our country. And so over time, I hope the twin man would succeed. I know how, I'm sure you know how I call him a twin man. He's okay. You know, so he's on course. Personally, he's on course. Ghanaians must begin to appreciate change and embrace it.
All right. As to whether it is a foreign idea, one thing that is not foreign to our Ghanaian politics or our economy is the debt ratio. Continuously, our debt have been appalling. Estimations have been given for the past 4 years, considering the alarming rate IMF has spoken by their assessment, World Bank has given projection. The recent report that was given in 2015 indicating Ghana's debt sustainability assessment indicates that our 10.9% of our revenue have mostly gone into debt refinancing. This and many more has been alerted by the business community, considering how government continuously borrows from the domestic market to refinance certain international debt. Also, there's been issue of whether we borrow in foreign currency and pay, considering the fact that we need more dollars domestically to refinance the debt. How is this situation going to affect businesses? We are going to get into assessment of that shortly with my guest at the moment, Dr. Ebenezer Mensah Achille. At the moment, we're going straight to the issue. So, Doctor, now Ghana's debt ratio. Can you take us through a bit of history and how far we've come without sustaining? From 2007, when we started going to the euro bond markets, we saw it as a light at the end of the tunnel. But here's the case where we are meeting the darkness at the end of the tunnel. Have we done much to enforce our own situation?
Thank you very much. That's a very good one. And I'm happy about one thing. The way Ghanaians try to narrow down the problem to the country and not necessarily look outside. Well, the popular cliche is if others are hitting high debt ratios and they are making it, it doesn't mean we should also go there. And that's a very good one. I like the way people begin to reminiscent the popular statement of the former president, Professor John Evans Atamiyo. He said, with this, we're trying to look up to ours. But sometimes in financial circles, economic circles, it's sometimes important to make some comparisons. Now, the debt in itself, since 2007, we've been piling up the debt. And if you look at some quick data that we have from last 2 years to date, you realize we've been hovering around the 90s. Now we are about, it's about 97. As of December, it was over 97 billion Ghana cedis, you know, with regards to the stockpile of debt. The question is this, when will this end at all? That is what is bothering on the minds of Ghanaians. And from 2007, the truth is that Ghana is now on the path of socioeconomic development. And therefore, the path to development comes with it some challenges. If you do not already have the financial resources to develop, then you have to look elsewhere for those resources. And until you are able to finish developing and then sitting down to reap the benefits thereof, you would continue to incur costs. And so that's what we are observing now. Since 2007, you realize the road expansion projects, the construction of hospitals, the construction of universities, all right, the rehabilitation of old roads, all of these have not stopped. They are continuing. And as a matter of fact, they are even not enough. And so we, at our stage of development, have become the popular character in the book called Oliver Twist. You know, we are always asking for more, and it is rightly so. And so if you are the government of the day and the people are interested in having the development projects carried out, how do you finance the project? It's a matter of meeting their demands or shirking your responsibility. And so if you want to meet the demand, where are the resources to meet the demand? If you cannot generate the resources internally, then you have to look elsewhere for the resources needed to be able to carry out the development project. You know, so what brings about this is going in to borrow. So as you borrow, unfortunately, in most cases, this borrowing will not be given to you by the lender at interest-free. You know, it may come under interest connect. and when it is due for payment, there will be some interest added onto it. And so long as we continue to crave and ask for development, the debt as we have may not reduce, all right? Yet the critical question that requires is begging for an answer, which perhaps will come there, is how the funds are utilized. That is what we must seek answers for. But as to the generation of funds externally to finance the project, that may take a while to stop. You know, if we do some comparative analysis, if you look at places like United States has over 100% debt to GDP ratio. It means the borrowing of the United States is more than even the GDP of the country as of 2015. For some countries, we have 89%. Others, we have 120%. Japan is over 200%. But Japan's situation is understandable. Because as a result of the earthquake, they had to reconstruct. And therefore, there was a need for external assistance to come in to be able to carry out the project as expected. You know, so the debt soaring up here, it's not something unusual to some of us, especially if you are in the realm of economics, finance, you know this is a reality. But the question has to do with how these funds are utilized within the economy. And so I would plead with Ghanaians, so long as we are developing, the borrowing might not be remote from us. It might not be remote from us for now. What options were available to the government? That's at the time of going in for that particular loan. And what was the dire circumstance, warranting the search for the loan at that particular moment? These two questions, the answers would perhaps lay some hearts to rest with regards to why that over 10% debt claim at that particular moment. Now, if the money was urgently needed, and which some explanations have been proffered, to justify, the question is how many options were available in terms of markets where you can borrow, and perhaps what were the interest rates that were being tabled at that particular moment? Was the 10.7% the lowest at that time? What were the conditions involved? So based on this, you'll be able to tell if it was justifiable. But if the money wasn't too needed, then there was no need for that. But some, as I said, some explanations have been provided. And we shouldn't forget that in our part of the world, governments come into power with strong promises. And you're expected to fulfill the promise before your term in office expires. If not, you may be shown the exit door. And so if you realize that night is drawing nigh and the necessary fulfillments have not been completed, then you may be forced to go in for some of these loans to be able to meet the needs of the people. Now, out of desperation, you might settle for anything at all that you are given. That is a fact. Now, it depends on the level of desperation or the level of amount of consideration that was put into the whole process. If not, there wouldn't have been the need for it. But the money, we are told, was needed at that time. But what some of us need explanations for is whether the loan was the only source that you could get, or the other quotations were more than 10%, and that was the lowest. Then in this case, you would what? Accept it. Now, comparing Ghana to Greece, the two countries are diametrically opposed to some extent. Now, it doesn't mean Ghana may not get there. But in terms of resources, I would say God has endowed us with certain natural resources, which you may not find in Greece now. Okay? Yes. Second, their level of development is a shade ahead of Ghana's. Now, that's what is happening in places like UK and then the United States. They have gotten to somewhat the peak of their socioeconomic development. So what they're doing is a rehash of what has already taken place. And when it so happens and you don't take care, you may end up incurring more debt because you may go in for the loan, but you do not have the resources to pay back. You may rely more on the fundamental source of government revenue, which is the tax, to be able to pay back. But as to the natural resource that you'll be able to extract and then use in paying, you may not have. So your source becomes one: tax, tax, tax. And so if the people are also not working, then how do they pay you the tax? So there is no any economic cyclical effect. That's what is affecting Greece now. But in our case, we are still at the embryonic stage of our development. We have the gold, we have the cocoa, we have the crude oil. So when it comes to West, we can rely on this, even sell them in their raw form to reduce the debt significantly. In our part of the world, the level of revenue generation through tax cannot be compared with the level in the United States, in UK, Greece, and other places. So viewers should be rest assured that we are distant away from Greece as we speak now. Because what we have to be able to at least pay off our debt, Greece may not be able to boast of that. You know, but it doesn't mean we should shirk our responsibility when it comes to effective management of the economy. That has to be controlled, and that is the beauty of strong opposition. It's the people with the intellectual capacity to be able to tell you that you are veering off the track, get back on the road, and be able to speed up effectively. So there's a difference between the two of us, actually.
All right. Late 2014 up until 2015, first quarter, second quarter, we saw the case of the Cedi having a bit of volatility because some of the leading factors being given was because of the international oil prices, and most of the exports are running import and this and this and that. But it appears that this year we've seen a bit of stability, but yeah. Most economists are not still optimistic about the stability, considering the amount of debt ratio we have, and also it looks kind of artificial and can break down any moment from now.
All right, thank you very much. Now, the clarification, when you talk about the stability and then the problems, they're actually not export outweighing import. It's rather the other way around. That's why we were having the volatility. And so the stability might come about as a result of control and check on the imports and allowing more exports to flow. We had problems because Ghana is an import-led economy. What it means is that we import more than we export. You know, yes, and I'm happy the government is a listening one and has fortunately been able to take some of these suggestions into practice. You see, the Youth Enterprise Support Initiative was initially intended to allow individuals to come out with their innovative entrepreneurial ideas and to be supported by the government through funding to be able to work. Some of us suggested that yes, it's a laudable idea, but it will be very useful and economically beneficial to the nation if the government officials prevail on the individuals to identify some of the basic things we import into the country and they engage in the production of those items, like the toothpick. You know, toothpick is developed out of bamboo. You know, yes, what we in local parlance known as pampro. Yeah, that is what is used in making toothpick in China. And we have bamboo in large quantities here, which could easily be transformed. What the individual may need in this case is a machine that will be used and we're trimming it to the expected size and then shape. So if we are able to...
So these are social intervention.
That is it. So if you're able, social and economic intervention, because socially you'll be able to make use of it. Economically, you empower the person. The person being set up will eventually be paying tax to the government. The person would also employ another person who would also be paying tax. So you end up solving unemployment situation and then you increase your source of revenue. Now the money that is given out is also not for free. You know, it is intended to be paid over time. At the moment, you say it looks unsolvable at the moment.
Yeah. Every day, the case, every government upon government have this case.
Let me clarify this. Even in our world of economics, even 100% employment is not approved. We don't approve of 100% employment. But when you do that, then you may end up inciting other negative factors that you want them to slip, like inflation. You know, so employment of about 95%, we live in a margin of error, plus or minus 5, is acceptable. But what it becomes unacceptable if you have unemployment of about 10%, 15. So here you would like to reduce the number to the barest minimum. In this case, if you're able to create the jobs for the people, then you reduce the overall unemployment rate. That is what we're looking at in this particular situation. So if you're able to set them up, then you'll be able to do exactly what we're talking about. Now we come back to the...
Before you come back, There's this assertion, like saying that a school of thought have it that most government interventions, social interventions, always hit the nag because of mismanagement. So far going forward, this particular Youth Enterprise
Support Initiative.
Yes. You know, is he likely doomed for that future as well?
I like the way you put it. It's not optimistic, but you're pessimistic. And let's take the pessimism in this particular situation, which is positive. You know, it is not going to hit a snag. This is the third time we had the JIDA. You see, the Ghana Youth Entrepreneur Enterprise Development Authority, which we did not see anything good out of it. You know, we had said that the Northern Accelerated Development Authority, you know, initiative, which also we did not see anything good out of it. And then we now have the Youth Enterprise Support Initiative. It is the same thing being what? Transformed with the hope that it will give us the result.
So with a change of name, a guarantee?
Not only change of name, but then the content has also changed. You know, the content has changed in the sense that the people being targeted now are a bit different, with some criteria set. You need to meet those criteria to qualify to benefit from it. And now the beauty aspect of it is that it is not too politicized. I'm using the phrase advisor that I said not too politicized. It means irrespective of a political coloration, you could qualify and benefit from it because it's about Ghana and not about the party per se.
Okay, you know? Let's see how the impact of most of the employment initiatives, or let's say how, okay, now let's get to the macroeconomic aspect. We've seen the inculcation of most of our oil revenue projections in our budget, but as a part of that is the reason why we still have a debt ratio increasing because of the fall in crude oil prices. What did we miss out? Because there was suggestion being made to the government to ensure or cause a hedge fund to support in case the oil prices fall. But this didn't, the government didn't yield to that.
Yes. Once again, you see the explanation, I wouldn't say argument, the explanation put forward by the government at that time was cogent. This is the whole thing. You are in this particular situation, finding yourself in the two worlds. Initially, you were in one world, and the one world was you only import the crude oil, you know, and then refine or bring it, import it already refined to use. But here's the case, you are also exporting now. And so if you want to hedge, then you have to engage in two double-edged sword situation. One, you have to hedge against the fall in the price of crude oil so that when it falls, you'll be able to maintain the world price that was going as at the time of hedging. And then what happens to the local market in this particular situation? Would you allow it to flow as it is? Or you also like to hedge it and then maintain a certain price level for it? You know, so if you look at this situation and you look at your precedents in the prior years, you hedged, how much did you pay for it? What was the end result? Economically, if you look at the cost you incurred and the benefit you derived, the two deducted, which one outweighed the other? So on the basis of this, you might try to tread cautiously. Because the very same people who might be touting or hailing you to go for the hedge, if you go in and eventually you incur too much cost, they will turn around and say you've increased the stockpile of debt of the country. So sometimes it's not about what people say alone, but you, the one at the driving seat, will have to do the cost-benefit analysis and see if it is rational and economically beneficial at that time to engage in that economic act.
So was that the reason why Ghanaians were forced to pay what they call realistic prices on the...
Yeah, because now it is being allowed to be detected by the market. So there is this, it depends on the prevailing market price. So the fluctuation, the only problem has to do with government hesitance sometimes to reduce the price as it falls on the market. In advanced economies like the United States, if the price falls today, immediately it reflects at the oil pump, the pump. You understand? You go there and then the oil you buy, in this case diesel or petrol, has the price reduced automatically. But in our part of the world, it takes some time because the government's control has not been weaned off completely.
That was under the automatic price adjustment.
That is not under. That is what is supposed to prevail. If you want deregulation and allow the dictates of the market to determine the price of the crude and the oil prices, then that is the automatic price adjustment formula. That's what has been adopted. But its implementation is not absolute. When I say Not absolute means not 100%, because
initially, 7 months ago, yeah, when the deregulation formula came in and was, yeah, instituted, we saw every 2 weeks somewhere there were allegations that this was part of the IMF conditionalities, that, yeah, oil prices would be reviewed at least for every fourth quarter of a month,
okay,
to ensure there's equitability in price determinations by, okay, the oil marketing companies. But, okay, we also seen the case of when the crude oil prices was falling, mm-hmm, the expectant result or to the ordinary Ghanaian, to the any businessman, was not seeing a reflection, mm-hmm, amidst the already doomsday situation that we were in. So, yes, what is lost to the Ghanaian that they need to understand?
Again, thank you very much. I like the way you put this statement, that there was an allegation that the, as part of the IMF conditionalities, the price of the crude oil or the oil will have to be reviewed at a certain point in time. Well, if it indeed part of the conditionality, then that is most unfortunate, and the government does not have to buy into it, because the IMF officials, you know, come from country where the government does not meet periodically to review the price of crude oil. The government, they have compelled the government to leave the determination of the price of the crude oil to the private sector completely. So I don't see why government should be compelled to come in to review, especially when the government has been compelled not to provide subsidy. If the government is subsidizing, then she can come in periodically to review to see if there's a need for upward adjustment to make sure that some part of the debt is what is recovered. But if the government has passed on the 100% subsidy onto the consumer, then government has no business periodically reviewing the price of crude oil at all. You know, yes, and I have said this somewhere, and the government officials are aware. I believe in government officials speaking as the authority determining what should be done, and not necessarily what IMF has directed us to do, as if we don't know what to do. Without IMF, you don't know the way forward. But we have many people here who have many years of experience and could even help the IMF officials to chart their course. Readily, I'll mention the very man whom during the early stages of my life, whenever there is the year for the review of budget, we ran to the radio to listen to him without even understanding his vocabularies, Dr. Kwesi Boutwe. You understand? All these people are around, and they have years of economic experience that they bring to bear on what is happening. And so it will be very unfortunate for us to be speaking now and at every second quote the IMF. The IMF said this, the IMF said that. Don't we have the people who can determine and chart the course of our economic destiny here? It's unfortunate. The IMF can suggest. But given our socioeconomic and cultural environment, it is up to us to see if what they are proffering, you know, fits directly into our system. If not, we review to see what we do. And people have been doing that. So people should begin to accept responsibility and speak on authority rather than always say that IMF said this. I was watching a particular TV program, and one deputy finance minister was saying the IMF is watching. Quickly, I just stood up and then left. IMF is watching what? You are in charge. You know what you need in your country. IMF is watching what? Tell people this is good, and that is why we are advancing it. Just as from here, you can also provide suggestions for people in the United States. If they look at it and it suits into the economic system, they'll buy into it. But it will not be a matter of Ghanaians are watching or Ghanaians brought this. Accept it and then develop it yourself.
Let me take your impression or opinion about this. When the country was experiencing economic turmoil, recession likewise, yes, a lot of experts in the field of economics and finance were encamped at Senchi to drop the Senchi consensus. People were optimistic. The outcome of it was a lot of optimistic through the media. We saw economists and professionals who have years of experience giving analysis on detailed information about how they intend to see the country in the next 3 years. Should the sensitive consensus be followed prudently?
Yeah.
It wasn't long until we saw the endorsement of the IMF conditionalities.
Yeah.
So join our domestic policy and encampering a foreign one in the name of adhering to international credibility. That was one of the reasons the government state that for the credibility status in the international community. Is that a best approach to dealing with issues that are symptoms of domestic mismanagement?
Domestic mismanagement, that may be a strong phrase, but the truth is that, let's get some clarification here. And the reason why I believe the government officials must take up what is happening, and if there is any credit at all, it should be both sides. You know, the after the Senchi Accord, the people that met developed what you call the homegrown policies. You see, it is the homegrown policy that was tabled before the IMF officials as to where the economic experts expect to see the country heading to. The IMF officials reviewed what has been detailed, and then they made additions to it. You understand? So what is being implemented now isn't 100% foreign policy. It's about 70% or more domestic policy. That's what I don't understand when people are mentioning IMF. These are ideas that were generated by people from within. And then table. It's just like you going in for a loan from a bank to set up a business, and the bank asking for a proposal. So you table your proposal, the bank reviews it and realizes that, no, this is a very laudable one, and you should be given the necessary impetus and push financially to move. That is what actually happened. And so it isn't a complete paradigm shift from the initial idea to a new one. No, that's what is being implemented. And people who toiled, who put up sleepless night to put up this particular information need to, you know, own up and be counted as such. That is my point. People have done good job here, and they shouldn't hide behind the cloak and only be trumpeting home IMF. That is what I'm saying. You see, some of us have access to this document, the homegrown policy, and knowing where it came from. I don't see why people should relegate themselves to the background entirely and then pretend everything is coming from without. No, people have done very good work here. And so what is happening here, the economic turnaround we are witnessing is as a result of collaboration of Ghanaians and then their foreign counterparts. Most of these people might have not only been with the World Bank and IMF, but have worked with African and Ghana as a country for years, and are therefore familiar with our economic terrain and know how to suggest and then lead us from the potholes onto the highway. And so that is what is actually happening. It shouldn't be taken as being out of place. The Senchi was born out of suggestions by people that, yes, if you remember, before Senchi, there were some strong economic difficulties. People were calling for the head of the finance minister, but some people suggested, no, it shouldn't be after that. This man is a listening man. What he needs at that time was a holistic approach. People should be brought together, put their heads together, and be able to turn things around. And that is how Senchi came into being. And its effect is positive. And so we should ride on the positive effect and be able to develop the country as expected.
Dr. Eben, now we're looking at the $2.5 billion has been projected in 2016. That will be the case of our debt portfolio. How would this reflect from the point of international investors, considering the impact analysis of debt on the country's development?
Again, thank you very much. Now, when it comes to the impact of debt on the country with regards to the foreign investors, fortunately, most foreign investors or investors look beyond just the debt. They have questions that they seek answers for. And one of these questions is, what did the country contract the loan for? Do you have any evidence to buttress the contract of the loan? If this is there, what are the infrastructure development that have been carried out that will make it possible for my establishment of company to thrive in the country? And so if you've been able to put up the necessary social and infrastructural facilities in place to ease the investment process, then the foreign investor might not be too keen on how much debt you've incurred. Because objectively, as an investor, he or she knows that sometimes you incur more than you derive at the moment, but over years you'll be able to recoup. And so if there is some, if there is strong evidence to buttress the debt that you have filed up, then the investor will know that you are on course. And that wouldn't have a negative effect. However, if huge amounts have been quoted and you do not have the infrastructural facilities to back the amount, then they may not have confidence in you and they may look elsewhere. So that is one thing. Now, one other issue has to do with the debt that we're talking about. These are projections. In 2013, the projection was that it will hit $900 million. All right. Now, based on calculations that were done this year using the last quarter of 2015 in relation to 2013, we are being told it is expected to be about $2.5 billion. So it is an expectation. It is not an actual figure. So we are still within the projected figure. And the good aspect of it is that the one in Helm of Affairs is an opportunity for him to be able to look out for the remedies, the remedial measures, and be able to reduce the projected amount down to the barest minimum. Because the year has not ended yet. We are now in the middle of it. You have 6 more months for this expectation to become a reality or just a mirage. And so it will be in the best interest of the country to transform it from a reality to a mirage, because it will be in our best interest. It is still a projection, and that could be withered away. Now, the difference.
Likely that going into, before the end of this year, the debt is likely to go way above the 100 million Ghana cedis projection, considering the fact that just this morning, there was information that the government is likely to hit the domestic market to still borrow to finance some projects in the country. But how will this impact on the interest rate and also the crowding out of private enterprises and accessibility of loans in the domestic market?
Well, when it comes to the interest rate, if the government steps in to borrow, then obviously, the amount of money in circulation will reduce. And so if the amount of money in circulation reduces, then there will be limited funds available. The government can use its monetary policy instrument to regulate the interest rate at this particular moment. If not, then there will be excess demand over supply, which may lead help banks to review their rates upwardly. Fortunately, once again, the banks have a minimum and then, I don't know, the maximum cap within which they have to lend money to individuals and organizations within the country.
Wouldn't that create an induced inflation?
So, as I said, it may not be an overt or explicit inflation. Because if you're looking for the money, you'll be told there's no money. So perhaps behind the scenes, you may plead for the money to be given to you even at, say, 30%. If initially you as a company get it at 25, you may say, even if it is 30, give it to me, I'll buy. So here, an induced inflation would occur, as you're saying. But we're just hoping that this wouldn't be the situation in this particular instance. That one thing, the government can calculate and then determine the amount of money to borrow in order not to have a negative impact on the money circulation in the country, in the economy. And so it is very likely that the borrowing will take place, but its impact on the general lending wouldn't be negative in this particular situation. So it could be controlled. Once again, there's a projection. Interestingly, the estimated increase, which is about 1.6 billion, it's about 177.78% increase from the 900 million to 2.5 billion. It means the projected increase is about 177.78% increase. This we do not expect. Even the 900 million should even be beat down. It should be.
Concluding comments on the debt ratio portfolio.
Very good. Now, with the debt situation, as I've indicated, the problem with the debt situation has to do with two major factors. One, as you indicated, somewhere 2012, 2013, the Cedi was struggling against the major foreign currencies like the dollar, and so there was a reduction in its value in relation to these currencies. When you want to extend, you need more Cedis for that particular currency. It did not only end with the exchange rate, but it also affected the amount of money we receive whenever you sell to the foreign market, you understand? And so these are some of the challenges. And we're focusing too much on the three key exports, traditional and one non-traditional, that has come to gain roots, the gold, the cocoa, and then the crude oil. These are the three key major sources, they constitute about 80% of the foreign earnings of the country. The other non-traditional exports, like the export of pineapple, now we're trying to see if we can add sugar, you know, the smoked fish and others, they account for about 20% of the total export earnings. If you're able to increase the percentage of the non-traditional exports against the major one, then even if the price of gold and the price of cocoa falls, we'll be able to make inroads and not suffer as we're doing. So over time, I know Ghana will be a better place. Fortunately, the advent of democracy has changed the economic frontiers of the country a bit. And a bit will change to better, and then it will be best.
That is quite an optimistic projection.
Yes, I'm of the strong conviction that just as the musicians are deep in my heart, I do believe that we shall overcome. Yes.
We shall overcome. That is left to see by the reality of the market and whether the nation's policies will streamline us and how we can revamp and get more revenue to tackle our debt refinancing strategies. You're watching BTA Politics Live on Business Television Africa. Today, my guest on the bill is Dr. Ebenezer Mensah. He's my guest and he's a financial analyst and also the Dean of School of Business and Leadership. We're going to a very sensitive issue that has come to light. Continuously we've heard about the Ghana Water Company trying to institute certain policies or, let's say, measures to streamline the efficiency of collection of revenue to revamp the company back to its feet. But at the moment, we've been questioning and continuously the inculcation of technology as a means of making sure that things are done prudently. Just recently, they released information that shocked everybody. That has to do with the use of scratch card as a means of payment by the Ghana Water Revenue. We are going to see whether, particularly, how will this system be run and whether it will be prudently efficient, and also would there be the case of non-payment or also the payment, what are the challenges technically and let's say financially that this particular system will be facing. Because if you don't assess it prudently, in the near future, situation will come up that will be beyond the recent economic challenges that we are facing currently as a nation. So now we go to the water bills to be paid with scratch cards, according to the Ghana Water Company. What is your take on that? I see you smiling already.
Yes, I'm happy that our company at long last is not leaping slowly, but leaping very rapidly, you know, moving from one stage to another technologically. I remember for over the years, we see the meter reader man comes to the house, who open on top of the meter, take down the number, and give the previous periods bill out, and then record and wait for the following month for another one. Sometimes it may take 2 or 3 months. In that particular situation, when the meter is red, you may have to brace the challenge of having about 3 months of what bill to receive. It's refreshing to hear that there have been some changes, but the changes have brought in their wake some challenges that the Ghana Water Company will have to address. One, the company started first by allowing people to make payment of the bills using Airtel money. Now I have people who have approached me to lament about the fact that twice they've made payment using Airtel money and the payment never reflected on the subsequent bills that were sent to them. Now they sent the evidence of payment through Airtel to the Ghana Water Company's customer service officers, and the employees there couldn't help. They were clueless as to how to solve the problem. And so does it mean only the account section or a group of people went into agreement with Airtel to collect the payment without providing the necessary training for the Ghana Water Company employees to know how to address the situation, or let the customer service associates know that whenever a client comes with a problem of non-reflection of payment, perhaps call this Airtel line to have the issue resolved. Nothing of that sort. And so that particular problem is hanging on the neck of Ghana Water Company. And interestingly, a new dimension has been introduced. I'm just hoping that the personal digital assistant that they introduce will be very effective in this particular situation. And as is done in any scientific research, it has been given a pilot steady.
Let's take the ECG as a case study to the
Ghana Water. Okay.
Because the ECG, until the research being conducted by GM Research, yeah, which brought out the revelation that Ghanaians were being overbuilt, yeah, which caused a review of their whole system instruction concerning the software that was being used.
So that the source was GM, right?
GM Research, yes. Conclusive research. We did a factual-based analysis on the situation.
Pats on your shoulders, you know.
Oh, yes, yes. We have a whole stock.
That's GM there for you.
Exactly. Now, with that particular, using the ECG as a case study, if you go to, customer complained that when you go to ECG, you have to queue with the option, with the statement being made that they have internet problem. We've seen a lot of that challenges, and it hasn't still been restored. So moving to the water bill system, would that also not double the whole situation of our utility payments?
In this particular situation, when it comes to a problem with effective determination of the units consumed, it may be too early for us to preempt judgment. We would have to allow the system to roll into effect and see the outcome. However, it's an opportunity for us to make a clarion call to the Ghana Water Company to learn from the problems or challenges of the electricity company of Ghana to ensure that the actual meter reading figures, you know, are used in determining the amount that the consumer has to pay. That we have to trumpet home. They have to work against that particular negative incident. With that, they will be able to go places. Now, my understanding is that the personal digital assistant has been imputed with the necessary computation to allow it to determine automatically if it is a domestic meter or commercial meter, depending on the number of consumed figures. It will tell you instantly how much you owe. And then you go to the necessary Ghana Water Company office to buy the scratch card. Now, this is the question that is begging for an answer. When the individual walks to the necessary Ghana Water Company office to buy the scratch card, what information should he or she carry along? Do I go with bare hands and say, I'm just coming to buy a scratch card? Because the available information is silent on this. We should know that, for example, you have to carry your bill along to enable the seller, perhaps if some preliminary information has to be captured, then with the bill, the necessary information will be captured. And when you call the Ghana Water Company to make the payment over the phone, what information do you have to provide? It's also silent on this. Doesn't mean I can just stand anywhere and say, I want to pay my bill. My name is this, and that is all. I need to know the account number on the bill and others. You see, Ghanaians sometimes will not live up to the expectation. You don't presume they know until you tell them. So if this basic information is required at the time of buying the scratch card or only at the time of making payment, then the consumer should be made aware. Because people might leave the bill somewhere and then make a call and say, I want to pay, only to realize, no, he or she might have to wait till he or she gets home, lay hands on the bill before payment could be effected. So the information should be complete, and we'll be able to work with that. Unfortunately, some key areas have been selected as the pilot area, like Tamar.
Do you say this will be cost effective, considering the printing of the scratch cards, yeah, and whether these scratch cards could be available at the needed point? Because even look at the telcos, you go and buy a card to upload on your phone, yeah, and you go to places you don't have them available. Is that going to create a situation of scarcity?
Well, the scarcity would depend on the number of connected water taps within the country and the number of scratch cards that will be made available for sale at a given point in time. So before the prints are made, the ECG, the Ghana Water Company, in this particular GWLC, has data on the number of connected, the officially connected taps within the country. You know, so on the base of this, you print and then print in excess. Because some people may not buy once. For example, if the person owes 20 cedis, he or she may decide to buy a scratch card for 5 cedis and make part payment. You know, so you have to make room for all of this. You consider all of this in your permutations before printing out so that you don't run out of the cut in this particular situation. When you ask for cost effectiveness, it is highly cost effective. If it's successful, one, then people that are needed to come round and then issue the bills, the number will go down. Over time, it may be faded out. When people begin to understand and appreciate it, then the individuals at a given period in time would go and then ask for the scratch card. So the Ghana Water Company would not even necessarily have to send people to go and distribute, because the distribution of the bills will no longer take place. It's up to you to know the consumption rate and then buy the scratch card and make payment. If you don't pay, I'm sure the system will be digitized such that your tap could even be locked or blocked from remotely, and you'll not be able to have water flowing. So you will be compelled to go and buy the scratch card and pay. Here, you don't need people going around and being paid.
So with that kind of not enough monitoring on that aspect, yeah, because there will not be much monitoring if the system comes up.
Yeah.
So wouldn't that also create an opportunity for manipulation of the system by some individuals or customers? Because if you're not coming around, I can create the pipe in my home without having the meter being plugged.
Yeah, but if the information that has been made available is anything to go by, then we can be rest assured that that illegal connection will be detected, because the explanation indicates that the new system will help to even detect where there's a bypass or illegal connection. You know, so there will be no need to be physically present. But it doesn't mean the people would effectively or completely be phased out of the system. Once in a while, you may have some gray areas where you note as well problematic. In these areas, you may have to deploy employees constantly to make sure that they are familiar or abreast of happenings with regards to the flow of water in that particular area. So some areas wouldn't need individuals at all, because the people there are, for the lack of a better word, discerning, and wouldn't go contrary to what is expected of them. You know, in other words, they will know they have to pay, they will know they will not have to bypass and have the legal process connected. But in some areas, you may need people deployed to constantly check to make sure.
Wouldn't this affect the state of businesses, considering the fact that we are always advocating for cheap access to utility,
yes,
such as light and water? Now, with the implementation of this system, how is it going to, because it appears like we are being imprisoned in the 21st century,
yes,
kind of slavery.
Through digital means, right?
Yes.
Now, with this, objectively,
because if you don't have the car, that means water will not flow from your house.
Yeah,
is that not going to be the case where the government determines how systems are run,
yeah,
but not systems determine how the nation is run?
Okay, that is very true. But at the outset, I don't think that is the situation. I don't think the system has been developed to make it difficult for individuals to access water flow if they've not been able to acquire a car. That is not the situation. However, the initial system or process is to make sure that you don't pile up the debt with regards to the water bills, you understand? So through the scratch card, you'll be able to reduce the amount you owe. And if you look at the two sources of utility supplies, i.e. the electricity and water, water is the one that is very silent with regards to debt. In other words, the cost is quite relative, and people are able to pay it more than the electricity supply. I don't think we even come to the situation where it will be blocked, as I suggested, because in the advanced economies, they know that water is a basic necessity. And even in the midst of all digitized payment systems, water does not follow that suit. Even though payment is assured, and it has not been subjected to such a rigorous, you know, blockade whereby people will not have access to water. So I don't think we'll get to that much. It is just intended to improve the system of revenue collection. In other words, there will be efficiency in the revenue collection, and that would add up to the various sources of revenue for the country. If objectively we have enough source of money from the water company, then there will be no need overburdening individuals with some taxes. You know, the loopholes and shortfalls in those areas are what account for the increasing of the main tax sources. Because if I'm not deriving from this source, then the regular source, let me increase the rate a bit to be able to make for the shortfall. That's what is happening now.
So, viewers, I'm sure you are enjoying the show right about now. You're watching BTA Politics Live on Business Television Africa. Today, we delve on the case of Ghana's debt hitting $2.5 billion, and also the institution of a scratch card by the Ghana Water Company, whether this is a prudent approach to ensure efficiency in revenue collection. At the moment, you're going for the political news. We tell you BTA Politics is a most segmented political business program where we give you updates on what is happening in the field of politics. So right about now, we go for the political news. We'll be right back shortly for more on BTA Politics. Okay, welcome back from the short break. Now, right about now, we delve on the one final issue that has been very sensitive in the House of Parliament. There's been a lot of debate on it, whether to go or not to go. That has to do with the Ghana National Petroleum Corporation's use of some amount of money to restructure a new idea, let's say, system they intend to run. That is bringing the oil companies under one roof and naming it the Energy City. The amount of money that these companies have been paying as rent, according to DNPC, is so astronomical. Therefore, it is prudently wise for them to inculcate or have them in one building structure that will have all of their operations systemized. But the House of Parliament have been debating about it. But let me get the thought of Dr. Ebenezer on this particular issue, whether it is prudently the right approach by the DNPC to apportion this huge sums of money for the oil city project they intend to embark on. So, Doctor, this particular project by DNPC is in the House of Parliament, debating here and there. Minority says this, majority says that.
Yes.
But what do you say about it?
Well, once again, thank you very much. It isn't too dicey as we make it look. If I listen to both sides of the argument, both parties have strong points. Now, the underlying objective of setting up this particular city is to be able to house the various oil companies, not just house them, but with some economic benefit undertone. You know, if the estimation by the petroleum minister is anything to go by, and it is a truism, then it is allowed to have this particular project carried out. And what is the statement? It is that the petroleum companies, the Talo, the Cosmos, and others combined together in the country spend about $20 million, you know, on rent annually here. And if this is the case, then the Ghana National Petroleum Corporation can put up equally befitting structures, just as though they have rented, and then let it out to them to be able to rope in the money into the government coffers. It's a genuine one. Now, the argument of the minority has to do with the cost of putting up the structure, which is over 115 million Ghana cedis. You know, now if you are to round this up to the nearest whole number, which is about 120 million Ghana cedis, and you want to divide this by even four, then it means about $40 million. That's the cost of the structure. You know, about $40 million. Now, if you're able to incur this cost to put up the structure, and in a year you are able to make $20 million, then it means in 2 years you'll be able to recoup the total amount spent on the project, and from year three onwards, whatever you receive will be profit to you. So this is a basic capital project analysis. That is the argument there. Now the minority is arguing that yes, it's a laudable idea. However, given the cost of construction in the country, the location and the materials involved, they are not convinced that the putting up of the structure will cost that much. You're getting the point. So here it is up to the petroleum minister and his department, that is the Ghana National Petroleum Corporation, to be able to provide detailed cost analysis of how they arrived at the 115 million Ghana cedis, present it And when everyone is satisfied, then it will be approved.
Apart from the financial aspect, how would this going to impact on job employment? And how would the Oil City make any difference from the normal buildings that they are?
Significantly, it will even help address what we normally call the transitional unemployment situation. It will address that the transitional unemployment is where employment is created, but not a permanent one. So it helps to create a stopgap with regards to the number of people that are unemployed over a given period of time. The construction in itself will mean construction firms will be engaged. They would also hire people to work. And so just like we have the Kwame Nkrumah Circle overpass, people working for consecutively over 1 year, this may also be the situation where people will be constantly in the workplace, working, being paid. They will also take care of their wives and children. They may even extend to their parents. And so it will help create employment situation which will not end there, but will help improve on the economic well-being of individuals. There are some people who are even struggling to pay, think about how to pay their rent at the end of the month. If this should take off, then the issue of rent payment may be a thing of the past, at least throughout the duration of the construction. You know, after that, depending on the space, these oil companies may even increase the number of people that they have employed to work with, because the space and the amount they pay might not be corresponding or correlating positively. Then the government will perhaps provide more space at the same cost as they are paying now. And so the more space they have, the more opportunity is created for extra hands to work, to be hired.
Well, okay, I'm sure some of the suspicions have been because some of these oil companies, some of them are foreign-owned companies. Yes. Why wouldn't they decide to allocate a certain portion of their profits or revenue to embark on such similar projects in the long term rather than embarking on government subventions in the short term?
Now, once again, with the basic analysis I carried out, if indeed the 115 million Ghana cedis, all right, the amount is anything to go by, and you should even set it up. By the time you complete, you might even increase the rent from the 20 million estimated dollars to about 21 or 22. But let's even maintain the same amount. It means all things being equal, within 2 years, you'll be able to recoup the amount involved. Now the oil companies are not trying to settle. First, they are working on their oil fines. And so it is about first things first and other things second. So with the focus on the oil fines, it may take a number of years for them to settle before think about having permanent structures here. By the time they go in for the permanent structure, you would have even already recouped the amount you have spent. The incoming amount will be profitable to you. If they do not even take it up anymore, you may convert it from being offices to maybe a mall, or look at what it will befit and then convert into that. Fortunately, you are constantly marketing the country as the hub of what? Investment in Africa, not only West Africa. And so you don't even limit your frontiers to the oil companies. Before they even say jack and want to move out, you'd have already contracted people who would take up the structure from them. So depending on the management style, it will be a continually gold mine to the country.
We've seen Tor having a lot of challenges due to certain strategies. That was implied years back.
Yes.
We saw the implementation of Tor levy on petroleum products.
Yes.
The objective of this is to revamp Tor.
Yes.
We see GNPC also has some challenges, but at the moment we've seen them coming back to their feet.
Yes.
But all has to do with whether prudently those institutions have really worked according to the structure of business being run in order to ensure that much revenue is being made. Why would the government decide to allocate such amount of money to a company that has, over the years, been struggling to stand on its feet?
Well, if you look at Ghana National Petroleum Corporation, I don't think it has been struggling that much. We should all not forget that when it comes to the sponsorship for the senior national team, the Black Stars, the Ghana National Petroleum Corporation stands out tall. It is the major sponsor of the Black Stars. You know, so if it is a company that is struggling, I don't think it will have excess reserve to be able
that
to.
That is even questionable. Why the Black Stars amongst all that? Why not just the Black Stars? Because there are issues of projects, infrastructure problems you have in the country.
Yeah.
why wouldn't they use the people's money to deal with that instead of sponsoring the Black Stars? We can have fun, play 90 minutes games, but the number of sports hospitals, the best in the hospitals are not many. The people, in fact, mortality rates are really high. You go to the markets, most of the structures there are dilapidated, and they are not even, they can't withstand the test of time. So, economically, is it prudent?
Yes, once again, thank you very much. Now, the Ghana National Petroleum Corporation has been a domestic institution for a very long time. You know, domestic means it is, its operations are exclusively within the frontiers of this country, and by extension, perhaps to some West African countries, because Ghana is noted for servicing her African neighbors for some time now. Now, with the advent of the crude oil discovery, GNPC automatically has become a world market player. And so it is very important for GNPC to market itself. Now, when you watch the English Premiership, you watch international competitions, we see T-Mobile, you know, we see Delta Air embossed on the jerseys of players. What does that tell you? You'll be sitting in Ghana but watching organizations in the United States, in Great Britain and other places. And so GNPC, realizing that the Black Stars is one model social club within the country that's able to transcend beyond our borders with ease.
So the objective of that is for brand advance.
That is it. That is it. So when GNPC, you know, sponsors Black Stars, it is like a father sponsoring the son. It is the same family. You know, Black Stars invariably is owned by the whole of Ghana. GNPC is owned by the whole of Ghana. So if you are fortunate that Black Stars has, as a club, as a group, has one particular Ghanaian institution that is taking care of its social and financial challenges, then that's a plus to us. You know, so instead of waiting for direct outflow from the government, it comes through government agents. So that's a government agency working on behalf of the government. Now, it is intended to brand GNPC so that when it goes into the world of the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries, and we say GNPC, through the Black Stars appearing at the World Cup, those Arab nations that may not be too familiar with what pertains in places like Ghana, at least through the World Cup, when they see GNPC written, and the officials of GNPC appear at the negotiation table. Oh, GNPC, the one on the jersey of the blaster. That is what is happening now, okay?
So, finally, before we go, what must we not do in our oil revenue management?
Yes, it is what in economics and finance we call the Dutch disease. You know, the Dutch disease has to do with the negative experience of the Dutch when they first discovered oil. And there was over-concentration on oil at the expense of other sectors of the economy, and they paid dearly. Unfortunately, Nigeria followed suit in the 70s after the discovery of oil. They neglected the agricultural sector, and it didn't help at all. We have two strong cases to guide us to make sure that, in as much as we develop the oil sector, focus would also be on the manufacturing, the agricultural, and the service sectors of the economy, so that we'll have a holistic development of the country. The saying goes that he who follows, you know, observes carefully the steps and the glides of the leader. And where he, the leader, falls into pothole, you make sure you walk on the smooth path. And so this is what I would advocate. And I know the individuals in Helm of Affairs are strongly aware. They listen to some of us, and that has already been taken seriously. And that is the reason why we hear more about the gold, we hear more about the cocoa still in the system. The three areas and the non-traditional, you know, recently you heard the president talking about the sugar. All of these are not only intended to revamp and revive the factories that the first president put up, but to expand the frontiers of our exporting activities. And when we do that, the issue that we have with the economic analyst coming out easily to tell us that our the debt payment ratio will hit $2.5 billion, that wouldn't be an easy determination if we're able to improve on that.
Okay.
And that is why I told you at the beginning, I know we are closer to the place and we'll get there.
All right.
Because God has given us the necessary manpower, skills, and the economic resources needed to put together to get to where we want to go.
All right. Dr. Ebenezer Mensah has been my guest today on BT Politics. Doctor, it's a pleasure having you on the show.
It's always a pleasure.
Thanks for coming. Always a pleasure. Thanks. Okay. So thank you also, my viewers, for making time to watch BTA Politics. You've been watching us live on BTA. Also, we are on the internet. If you just, in case you have access to internet, just log on to www.businesstvafrica.com. We are also live on First Digital, FTV, and more on some sub-radio stations across the country. So stick and stay with us on more shows on BTA Politics. Also, I'll tell you, first of all, I'd like to say thank you to our sponsors, GM Foundation and Grouping Doom, for taking the initiative to bring about this best program in Ghana, where we give you an election update and economic update on what is necessary for national development. And also thanks to my producer, Anna Maria Nyame, for fantastic production, and also to my cameraman and crew behind the scenes, doing an amazing job. Nanat and Ofori, say thank you very much. Also a fantastic man, always solidly behind me on this show. My name is Winston Taki, and I brought you BTA Politics tonight. So then, have a good evening and enjoy the rest of your day. Bye-bye.